If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, and by what we have done, and by what we have done to them. We have not loved you as our Lord.
God in his infinite love has had mercy upon us and sent his only begotten Son into the flesh to bear our sins and be our Savior. Therefore, in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
When he calls to me, I will answer him. I will rescue him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation.
He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty.
I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust.
Because you have made the Lord your dwelling place, the Most High is his refuge, and we shall show you how no plague from you to attend.
You will tread on the lion and the adder, the young lion and the serpent you will trample on your foot.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
When he calls to me, I will answer him. I will rescue him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
First reading from Samuel, 17th chapter. Then David took his staff in his hand and chose 5 smooth stones from the brook and put them in the shepherd's pouch. The sling was in his hand, and he approached the Philistine. The Philistine moved forward and came near David, with his shield bearer in front of him. And when the Philistine looked and saw David, he disdained him, for he was but a youth, ruddy and handsome in appearance. And the Philistine said to David, "I am a dog, but you come to me with sticks?" And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. The Philistine said to David, "Come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and to the beasts of the field." Then David said to the Philistine, "You come to me with a sword and with a spear and with a javelin. But I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you down and cut off your head. And I will give the dead bodies of the host of the Philistines this day to the birds of the air and to the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel, and that all this assembly may know that the Lord saves not with sword and spear. For the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hand." When the Philistine arose and came and drew near to meet David, David ran quickly toward the battle line and met to meet the Philistine. And David put his hand in his bag and took out a stone and slung it and struck the Philistine on his forehead. The stone sank into his forehead and he fell on his face to the ground. So David prevailed over the Philistine with his sling and with his stone and struck the Philistine and killed him. There was no sword in the hand of David. And David ran and stood over the Philistine and took his sword and drew it out of its sheath and killed him and cut off his head with it. When the Philistines saw that their champion was dead, they fled. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading, a reading from 2 Corinthians 6th chapter. Working together with him, then, we appeal to you not to receive the grace of God in vain. For he says, "In a favorable time I listened to you, and in a day of salvation I have helped you. Behold, now is the favorable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. Put no obstacle in anyone's way, so that no fault may be found with our ministry. But as servants of God, we commend ourselves in every way, by great endurance in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, and imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, hunger, by purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, the Holy Spirit, genuine love, by truthful speech and the power of God, with the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left through honor and dishonor, through slander and praise. We are treated as impostors and yet are true, as unknown and yet well known, as dying and behold, we live, as punished and yet not killed, as sorrowful yet always rejoicing, as poor yet making many rich, as having nothing yet possessing everything. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And after fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. And the tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the brook. Five stones fished out of the brook that were used by David, though he only needed one to sink into the head of Goliath. Just as there were five covenants made in the Old Testament between God and man. Adam and Eve had a covenant with God, so did Noah and Abraham and Moses and now David. These five covenants that God made with man, symbolized by the stones, those covenants, the word of the Lord kept, honored, defended, the word of the Lord lived and experienced and known, the word of the Lord taken into battle. It didn't matter how big Goliath was, the word of the Lord, the promises of God, in all of those covenants brought together right there on the battlefield in the one whose body will issue forth the genetic material of no less than God in flesh himself. And it only takes one of those covenants, only one stone, only one command of the Lord in strength and might to defend his people, to sink into the head, the thick, empty skull of Goliath. The unbeliever, the idolater, the enemy, the incarnate symbol of everything Israel has failed to do, and it is crushed from the inside when the rock goes into the cranium. God's word that he promised would be, or commanded, should be on our hearts and our minds all the time. He literally puts it into the mind of Goliath by force. And it is the death of the giant. It is the same temptation across millennia of time and space, the same temptation given to a young boy who would stand up for the word of the Lord against this champion of the enemies of his people, this symbol of all their failures, and the one that comes forth as the promise fulfilled through all of those five Old Testament covenants to that one testament that God in flesh, Jesus Christ, would crush the head of the serpent. No longer through the proxies of David and Goliath, God in flesh confronts Satan there in the desert, having fasted and prepared, being ready for him. God has flesh indeed, but God is not sinful like we are. And God has free will indeed, unlike us since the fall. But God will not be tempted to betray himself, whether he will crush the head of the serpent. He will resist the temptation to do with those stones what Satan says to do with them. He will let it remain a rock, for he needs no bread. He will not throw himself down, and his army of angels need not rescue him. They were made for our benefit, to serve us, not the infinite and all-powerful God. And he has no need of the kingdoms of the world that the devil deludes and fools and tricks into obeying him, because ultimately, God is in control. God made flesh will return at the judgment day to judge all the kingdoms and peoples of the world, to separate the light from the darkness and make everything right. There is literally nothing that can be offered to God by Satan, because God owns everything. He owns the devil. At the instant, the infinitesimal instant that he decides to, he owns him outright, because he's a created thing. Despite his darkness, his hatred, and his resentment, the devil is nothing in comparison with the one he did. You and I, as Christians in the world, living under the name of Jesus and under his seal, we suffer the same fate as the Israelites. The temptation to give in to the world, the temptation to fail, the temptation to compromise. And we are always locked in this epic struggle against the world and the devil and against ourselves. Ultimately, it's you and me against you and me. Because we are not only locked in conflict between the unbelieving world, the idolaters, the persecutors of the church, Satan and his minions. We are locked into perpetual war within ourselves with our own sinfulness. We are Israel. We fail, we betray. We don't deliver. We don't keep the promises that God has written on our hearts. We are outside of being a covenant people by our rebellious spirit and our lustful flesh. But in that conflict also, we have that wellspring of eternal life from baptism on, springing up to everlasting salvation. The thing that separates us apart from the light from the darkness, the thing that puts us in conflict with ourselves, knowing good and evil and resisting the evil. Knowing that even in ourselves, we are weak and sinful and frail, and we are as much a failure as the world and the kingdom of darkness. It's we who go onto the battlefield with the five stones in our pouch to confront ourselves, the giant Goliath, collaborating with the world and the devil. But against that is Jesus, God made flesh, the one who fulfills the promise, the one that let David slay Goliath and from the temptation in the wilderness onwards, crushing the head of the serpent, is at work in us to deliver us and set us free. He goes to the cross and dies for the sins of the whole creation. He rises with power, proof of everything that he promised and said. But as living and risen Christ, he is with us still, with us in the font of baptism, with us in his body and blood in the Eucharist, with us, the living, eternal God, risen, victorious. Goliath is slain, though you and I still live in the valley. And our sinfulness will be purged and sifted away as surely as he lives. Both the labor of Lent and the promise of Easter, the glory of Jesus who conquers. The conflict is us against ourselves, but on our side, we have God. We have God in flesh, Jesus Christ. We have God the Holy Spirit indwelling to lead us, guide us, strengthen us, and deliver us. He will sink the rock of his word into our thick forehead until we are dead, so that he can raise us up to new and everlasting life, to a new and permanent, perpetual life in a new creation of joy in Jesus' name. Amen.
Suffering and argument, especially Pastor Goss and his family, and Marion,
Carl, Nathan, Jan, Carol, Donna, Ryan, Sue, Kevin, Mars, Ross, Margaret, David, Nicholas, Margie, Landon, Tabitha, Mira, Ezekiel, Rich, Jeff, and Rhonda. That Christ would be their good physician of body and soul in every need. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For all people in need of distress throughout the world, for all those to whom death is drawing near, and for us all, that when our last hour may come, we may depart this life with the confidence of a true faith, a right, devout, and holy hope, and together with all the faithful, be seated at the wedding feast of the Lamb, his kingdom which has no end. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Hear our prayer, O Lord, strengthen, deliver, and preserve us. For to you alone we ascribe, O Lord, and honor and power, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto you. Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and who opened the way for us to everlasting life. Therefore, with angels, archangels, all saints, and the whole company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying,
Thank you.
Now may this, the true body and true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you and keep you steadfast in the true faith, even unto life everlasting. Go in his peace. Amen. Amen. O give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
And his mercy endures forever.
The Lord be with you.
Spirit.
Let us pray. O God, the Father, the fountain and source of all goodness, who in loving kindness sent your only begotten Son into the flesh, we thank you that for his sake you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. And we ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.